I will touch a few issues regarding the global thing. So those are my disclosures. I sometimes make some advisory boards for companies that work also in Africa. They have programs, and I will touch about this. Actually, the important thing about viral hepatitis is that it was a little ignored for years. For example, at the European level, we tried to put programs, and there was no interest. But now it's the situation is actually changing, also because of the DAA, and so the excitement about that. Because people, this disease was a little bit ignored. It will not be ignored now that we know the magnitude, and also because it's one of the goals of the Sustainable Development Goal number 3. So now, together with AIDS, TB, malaria, and other diseases, neglected, chronic, we have hepatitis there. So, because I come from the HIV, I would like to touch very briefly what we did in HIV, what are the successes, and what are the things that we can learn, and also the mistakes that we can avoid. First of all, it has been an extraordinary experience, the issue of access, the global access for drugs in the HIV field. It started in Durban with the Global Fund and the PEPFAR, and then, so it has been an incredible movement. In a sense, it's an extraordinary example of global health. We know this, that we call it as a model for global health. And in fact, we have now, you know, 18 million people on treatment throughout the world, a lot in Africa, actually. With some impact actually coming in terms of mortality, not similar to what we had here, and we still have, but it's there. So what I have been criticizing, actually, for some years now, is this concept of ending AIDS. Because it's not true, we are not there at all. Although that's a goal, is 2030, but we need to also understand the barriers. And I think that the magnitude of the excitement towards getting on the fast track was exaggerated and also did some harm. UNAIDS and other UN organizations said, okay, we are at a crucial juncture. We need now to increase our efforts to end AIDS, but we need to do it well. Because the recent report of WHO says that, first of all, the decrease in mortality is not on target, let's say. But more importantly, is that the decrease in the incidence is not on target. And so there is something that goes wrong, let's say. They say, in fact, the decline of people, the number of people newly infected is stalling. So we try to understand why this happens, despite the enormous exercise in treating a lot of people. One reason is, maybe that we didn't use prevention enough, and let's say the attention was put a lot on treatment, which is also prevention, as you all know well in HIV. It's treatment is also prevention, but as the problem the mistake we did, and we all did, is that to put on treatment a lot of people. While we forget some of the important barriers, and also we forget to focus on key population. Those are the ones that increase the number of new infections. And actually, I wrote this a few times, and I was also attacked for being too negative. And even in this recent paper I wrote with David Wilson, who's at the World Bank for AIDS. I would like to touch one point that deals with vaccine, because we wrote that this epidemic will be not closed only with tablets. There is no epidemic that was closed without a cure or a vaccine. Now, for HIV, we have a cure. For HCV, we have a cure. We don't have, for HIV, neither a cure or a vaccine. And I think that treatment is great. I'm a clinician, I'm a treater, but I think we need new examples and we need to learn from some of the mistakes. First of all, for example, the diversity of the epidemic, which is exactly what I've been heard these 2 days. I mean, even HCV epidemic is diverse in terms of who is infected and also in terms of prevalence in different countries. And then the big problem is, again, the key populations. What we overlooked with HIV are the big key populations. I'm just listing some: the displaced, the homeless, the sex workers. And you know, these are similarities we have with HCV field. Look at the prevalence in sex workers with HIV. And actually, the criminalization of sex work is also a problem. And this is why what links the battle against HIV to human rights is the same that we should do with HCV, of course. And then the drug addiction, where HCV, but also HIV, is fundamentally driven. And look at the prevalence in IV drug users in the world and the incarcerated people. And also and you know that, for example, in Russia, this is an article that was published in Lancet recently, this perfect storm, you know, of people incarcerated and then going back out of the prison and getting HIV, TB, and HCV and putting it in and out. So it's really a kind of disaster. And look at NDSM, MSM. Of course, that's an incredible problem. We have not only the known prevalence and incidence in rich countries, but also in Africa, where actually this group is criminalized. So again, how these people can get out, you know, to and be tested or be cared for. And then that's very specific for HIV, the exploited young women. You know, we have 25% or 40% prevalence in some countries in Africa. And then the slums. I think that we forget that 1.5 billion people live in slums. And it's not just Rio. Slums are everywhere, are also here, are in Africa, are everywhere. So there is a very interesting Lancet paper on the health of slums. So this is something, so I'm just trying to get your attention on abandoned or fields that we, the researchers, sometimes didn't touch. So, but let me go to the innovation that brought the HIV, and then the examples that we can take home. For example, of course, the drug development was incredible, as it was for HCV, but remember that some of the drugs for HCV were developed because of the HIV drugs were there. And we know we are going now to long-acting drugs. Our friend from Canada spoke about this. There is not something similar in the horizon for HCV, but maybe time to think of it. Of course, in HIV, we had an incredible political commitment, at least selected, but strong. Maybe we miss this part for HCV. And then the community. The community is growing also for HCV, but it was instrumental in the battle against HIV, the community. And then the innovative financing. Our colleague was talking about this model, which is, but actually, HIV invented an innovative mechanism like the Global Fund, which is still an incredible innovation in financing health. And then the health system research. We started with an approach that was very vertical. We care for the HIV, but actually we now understand that the HIV care, the chronic care, and I'm referring mainly to chronic non-communicable diseases, it's very similar. I mean, how you can care for a chronic disease like HIV and non-communicable chronic diseases. But it's true that we are changing our care models, particularly in some countries. We are going to more integrated models of care, and now we are taking care not only of HIV, but also of TB, and now TB and HCV and chronic diseases. So it's what we call the integrated model of care that may be useful also to care for HCV patients in general, although it's curable, but there is a long way to go. But what is important, I think, is the differentiated models of care, is the demedicalization that we are using for HIV to be able to care for millions. And this is something that HCV treatment could benefit a lot, because what we do, we put the care of our patients in the hands of the community. So we have, you know, community care groups, community art groups. They can do everything, at least for some patients, when the patient is simple and when the therapy is simple or can be simplified, like for HCV, you don't need a doctor. You don't need a doctor. And so that's, and then I would like to touch what, finish with what Andrew Hill said. AIDS changed, in a sense, the understanding of medicines as, let's say, public goods. You know, TRIPS was changed in Doha after Durban in 2001, and allowing for, and this is the decrease in pricing, like what Andrew showed just after that. And this just thanks to this, we have been able to put on treatment 18 million people. And of course, what we say now is that this battle for universal access now can be an example for other diseases, particularly for hepatitis, for chronic diseases. You know, the price, I mean, we are talking about the price of anti-HCV drugs, but you know, a course of immune checkpoint inhibitors, you know, the new cancer combination, you know, the price of this course, $300,000. We are not talking about the $50,000, $80,000. And this is just a course of the two immune checkpoint inhibitors. And $300,000, I'm right. So the issue, the general issue is that there is a window opening. Millions of people will not get access. It's not only HCV, but HCV actually moved something, you know, also thanks to, I think it has been a kind of, you know, key to make people thinking, even the rich countries. That's because HCV, it was the first time that the rich countries also had a problem of access, had to prioritize their patients. I remember the initial times of AZT, that there was a lottery. You remember the lottery at the beginning? And so now, this is JAMA. We are rethinking. Even the governments are rethinking, or the WHO. We are rethinking at the rules. There is something wrong, as Andrew said. There is something wrong in how the price of the drugs is done and how it links with research and development. It actually is not, in some cases, it's not research and development. It's finance and development. It's F&D, not R&D. And this is the beginning. So even the WTO is starting to understand that something has to be changed. And this is a very recent Lancet paper that talks of the need to revisit the pricing, the development of essential medicine, if we want to go to universal health coverage, because this is the overall goal. So universal health coverage needs essential medicines at fair prices. And definitely, there are papers talking about the use of generics in rich countries. So I'm just saying that HIV has, in a sense, reframed the medicines as they are not public goods. You know, public goods are the parks, are the police. This is, economically, those are the public goods. But health and medicine may progressively be considered as public, common public goods. And so, I'm stopping by. I would like not to repeat what has been said, but why we need to go towards HIV, HCV elimination. And you know, you saw this. This is the recent global burden. You know how the hepatitis is going up in the ranking, and these are the goals of WHO. We have been seeing this during these days. Two little things I would like to point, remembering the HIV field. We know that HCV elimination is feasible because it's curable, and we have the basis to do this. Now, the problem that we discussed with other friends is the issue of why we want to treat everybody. And here it reminds me of the discussion we had at WHO when we did the guidelines between the individual benefit and the public health approach. You know, there was a kind of continuous, it's not a fight, but it was a balance between the public health approach and individual benefit. So there is definitely an important individual benefit in treating everyone, because we know the benefits of SVR. Let's say these slides talk about SVR, but it's the benefit of eradicating HCV from any patient goes beyond the viral load and beyond. And we know it improves quality of life. So we know that there is a benefit, an individual benefit for that. But again, the balance is between the societal need and the medical need, the personal need. And I think the idea of HCV elimination touches both, because on one side you have a benefit for the patient, and on the other side, by trying to focus more on the key population, I'm talking about the transmitters. So this is a population that we need to focus, because there we will find the public health benefit, the overall, because you know that some of our patients do not transmit, okay? So that's I think is a very important concept. Some of our patients are not transmitters. You know when the transmission occurred and why, in the past or in more recent years. But there is a population of high transmitters and also high recipients. A lot of patients that are at high risk of transmitting and being infected, and we need to focus on that, because this is the public health benefit. So to finish, this is the goal of WHO. I'm a little scared when I think the goals are great, because we have a goal. But it reminds me of the goals of HIV, that we are not there, you know? And this cascade, this is the HCV cascade, is very similar to HIV cascade, where, you know, we have incredible gaps. If you look at, overall the world, here we are 40%, 30% success. So, okay, we need to monitor, this Lancet editorial say only a step away from elimination, not sure. I think there are huge barriers still. Not only the price of drugs, as it's not only the drug pricing. And of course, those are the way forward. And actually, it was touched. We need to simplify. We need to simplify treatment. This is what we did for HIV. We said, okay, let's treat everybody. Let's take out the CD4. So that's a problem, because you need to have the CD4 to start. And I said, it doesn't matter. You are positive, you are treated. And we only used one regimen, we said, for the world, okay? That's a public health approach. They say, is this regimen good for everyone? No, it's good for 90%, but that's it. That's a public health approach. And maybe we don't need even to measure the SVR. Actually, it's the same for vaccines. When you vaccinate your kid, You don't do the you don't analyze the antibodies. You assume he got the antibodies. And if he didn't, doesn't matter, because the others will protect him. So that's the public health approach. You don't do, you know, a blood test to look if he got the meningococci antibodies. So we need to simplify the diagnosis and the treatment. And that's it. So I would like to leave you with this interesting paper that was published actually by Philippa and Nathan Ford, which is actually the tools that we need to investigate or to have in our hands to really address the global elimination of HCV in the world. And that's it, so I'll stop here. Thank you.